Traditionally, we think of black holes as stellar black holes formed when a star with sufficient mass collapses in on itself because the outwards radiation pressure can no longer withstand the inward force of gravity, and then they inevitably form a singularity and event horizon. Today, however, we're going to be discussing primordial black holes that formed at the very early stages of our universe immediately after the Big Bang, emerging from high-density regions of matter in which a big fluctuation occurs, such that you've got a region of increased amount of matter. Now, if the matter falls within its Schwarzschild radius, the speed needed to escape equals the speed of light, or in other words, it has become a black hole. I think that one of the most common misconceptions about black holes is that folks tend to think that every black hole is a stellar black hole. This isn't true. A primordial black hole is an example of a type of black hole that didn't form from a star. Another type of black hole is a supermassive black hole. Supermassive black holes are occasionally considered to be different from stellar black holes, but they're the same thing. The only difference being that supermassive black holes have millions of more solar masses than the common stellar black hole and tend to be located in the centre of galaxies. For all we know, the supermassive black holes in the centre of galaxies or any black holes we've seen this entire time could be primordial black holes, we just can't rule them out yet. The supermassive black hole in the centre of the Milky Way, Sagittarius A star, has 4 million times the mass of our Sun, for instance. However, primordial black holes, or PBHs for short, are very different. Their sizes can range from a few grams to possibly even to match the mass of supermassive black holes, depending on which formation model you look at. Or it's very possible that they don't exist at all. At the moment, we can't prove or disprove PBHs, but that isn't to say that black holes haven't been proven. That's another common misconception about black holes. Black holes do exist out in the universe and are proven, and have been proven for a long time. As long as a region of space contains a high enough density of mass or energy, general relativity tells us that a black hole will form. So most folks just assumed they exist. And with the first discovery of gravitational waves back in September 14th, 2015, the evidence for black holes is building every day. Actually, very recently, LIGO announced the fifth detection of gravitational waves. It was detected on August 17th and lasted for 100 seconds, which is way longer than ever before. But what's amazing about this detection is that it was from two neutron stars merging, whereas all the previous detections have been from black hole mergers. 130 million light-years away and 130 million years ago, two neutron stars were orbiting each other and due to their loss of energy through the emission of gravitational waves, they spiraled inwards and merged. Telescopes all around the world detected this in all areas of the electromagnetic spectrum. And around 1.7 seconds after the main gravitational wave detection, NASA's Fermi Gamma Ray Telescope identified a burst of gamma rays. This is fantastic news, because for several decades gamma ray bursts have been thought to come from neutron star mergers, but we lacked any evidence to be sure. This new area of astronomy has been a very fascinating one and continues to be so. Before any detections made by LIGO, it was always thought that the main source of gravitational waves would be neutron star mergers, and up until this detection it has only been black hole mergers, which is surprising because the universe overall has more neutron stars than black holes. But that doesn't necessarily mean that there are more black hole mergers than neutron star mergers. It could suggest that black hole mergers tend to produce more prominent gravitational waves, and only now have we had a neutron star merger close enough and strong enough to detect. And as our detecting methods improve, we may develop ways to detect primordial black holes. One possible way to detect PBHs is by their Hawking radiation. Stephen Hawking realised that black holes evaporate thermal radiation due to virtual particles popping into existence at the event horizon. Everywhere virtual particles are constantly popping into existence. They come in pairs, a particle and an antiparticle. After existing for an extremely short amount of time, the two particles recombine and annihilate each other. So, if you have one of these particle pairs pop into existence at the event horizon, one particle will fall into the black hole, but the other particle is able to escape into space. And when this happens, the black hole loses an extremely tiny amount of its mass. Hawking showed that black holes emit this Hawking radiation at a rate inversely proportional to their mass. So a light black hole evaporates very rapidly and has an associated temperature that is very high. A massive black hole evaporates much slower and has an associated temperature that is very low. And of course, primordial black holes, if they exist, will also be evaporating their mass away, although the process is exceptionally slow. Some PBHs that form straight after the Big Bang will be evaporating into nothing right this second, and some smaller ones will have already evaporated into nothing. A particularly interesting one is a black hole with the mass of 10 to the 15 grams, which is about the mass of Mount Everest. Anything formed 10 to the minus 23 seconds after the Big Bang with a mass below 10 to 15 grams or a billion tons will have all evaporated by today due to Hawking radiation. So, as these 10 to the 15 gram black holes are coming to the end of their lives, they're emitting Hawking radiation faster than they've ever done before, as their mass is very low. When these black holes reach the end of their lives and are emitting Hawking radiation at an exceptionally fast rate, we don't know what happens to them. Although we can't prove or disprove PBHs at the moment, we can answer another question: are primordial black holes dark matter? Despite us detecting dark matter only very recently, dark matter is estimated to take up 27% of all matter in the universe, while dark energy takes up a whopping 68%, and normal matter that we're made of and is all around us surprisingly only takes up 5%. So why did we think it was there before we had detected it recently? Well, the regular matter in the universe that seemingly makes up all the galaxies that we observe is not strong enough to hold these galaxies together. They are rotating with such speed that the gravity generated by the regular matter could not possibly hold them together. All the stars should be flying off into space, but they're not. So we suggested that there is an invisible matter, which we called dark matter, which accounts for this mysterious extra gravity holding the galaxies together. And our theory was correct. Very recently, two separate teams found this missing matter, which was found to be made of particles called baryons, linking galaxies together through filaments of hot, diffuse gas. How does this link to PBHs? Well, it's possible that primordial black holes are dark matter and is responsible for this extra gravity. If this is the case, then the PBHs should create obvious gravitational lensing. They would regularly pass in front of celestial bodies such as distant stars, galaxies and so on, and we would be able to see this. Depending on PBH mass, this would cause an effect known as microlensing, and well, we don't see enough of this. Now, that doesn't mean that it rules out all PBHs for being dark matter, but it does rule out a lot of possible masses. As well as this, we can also rule out the masses that have already evaporated by now due to Hawking radiation. This includes all PBHs lighter than 10 to the 15 grams, or about a billion tons. We should also be able to see the effects of these PBHs when they're travelling the cosmos. One such effect occurs as a PBH goes close enough and pulls apart loosely bound binary systems. And we see loosely bound binary systems. These observations are helping us constrain the possible masses of PBHs into a very narrow set. We're left with two options: either there are lots of PBHs with masses of around 10 to the 21 kilograms, so about the mass of a large asteroid like Ceres, or a much smaller number of really big PBHs, so around 20 to 100 solar masses. The latter is a lot less likely than the former option. So what does it look for the future of PBHs? Well, soon enough, we'll either see evidence of primordial black holes at these masses, or discover that PBHs are actually very rare, and that they aren't an explanation for dark matter. Or they might not exist at all. Comment down below your thoughts on PBHs. Make sure you subscribe for more content on astronomy and futurism. If you enjoyed this video, check out my most recent video or my playlist on black holes. Thank you so much for watching. Have a nice day.